The Multi-Regional Clinical Trials Center presents Health Literacy in Clinical Research, or How Ignoring Health Literacy Can Cause a Hiccup in Your Clinical Trial Effort. You can apply health literacy principles at every stage of a participant's journey through the clinical trial lifecycle. To explain, let's walk through these five stages in a fictional clinical trial. First, at the discovery stage, the goal is public awareness, to let people who might be interested in the research know about it. But do you think this potential participant knows if this sign applies to him? Do you think he understands this text? Next, here he is at the recruitment stage, being asked by his doctor if he'd like to join the research study. Do you think he understands her explanation of the study? Okay, so our potential participant is interested in joining the study, and now he's at the consent stage. Do you feel confident that he truly understands what is written on the form in his hands? Next, while he is on the study, he's supposed to answer survey questions and follow research procedures. Do you think he is able to confidently answer this question? Finally, at the end of the study, our participant is given some information about the results of the study. Do you think he knows what the researchers discovered? Okay, that was just a little introduction with hiccups that might occur if you ignore health literacy. So what is health literacy? Health literacy is a two-sided concept. Part of it is a person's ability to understand and use information to make decisions about their health. But it's also the obligation of the communicator to share information in an understandable way. So in the context of a two-sided relationship, health literacy includes writing and reading skills, talking and listening in the appropriate way, the ability to communicate and evaluate risk, and part of that is numeracy, which is being able to understand numbers, like percentages, or to interpret charts or graphs. In many ways, it really comes down to the presentation of clear information that is designed in a way to help the participant understand. But another important element is a person's belief in their own ability, on both sides of the communication. So who has low health literacy? It's kind of a trick question because health literacy can be situational. Low health literacy can affect anyone. Sometimes it happens when you encounter a new medical topic you are unfamiliar with. For example, maybe our patient here is a theoretical physics professor, a very smart guy, right? But that doesn't mean he knows the difference between atrial fibrillation and paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia. And stress can also affect health literacy, making it harder to process information that we might otherwise understand. So, if our patient goes to the doctor on a Friday, he might have a lower health literacy than he would have had on Monday, because after a full week of work, he's stressed out. People can also become stressed very quickly when they first receive a serious diagnosis, so it may be hard for them to process very much right after a doctor tells them they have cancer or presents them with other very difficult news. This means that limited health literacy can affect anyone. And low health literacy is associated with a lower trust of providers, lower satisfaction with care, higher risk of adverse events and hospitalization, higher use of emergency care, and lower likelihood of receiving preventative care. How does using health literacy best practices benefit clinical trials? Clinical research is often complicated and confusing. Addressing low health literacy in the design and communication of your clinical trial can improve the generalizability of your results, since individuals with lower health literacy are less likely to enroll in research. Using health literacy principles ensures a wide range of people can understand the information and be enrolled. Health literacy can help participants follow your study protocol. Lower health literacy is associated with incomplete follow-up, Helping participants understand the research will make it easier for them to follow the study instructions. Better adherence, better data. And materials that require high health literacy can put an extra strain on a participant's ability to answer as accurately or as truthfully as they can. But participants who understand the procedures may help produce more valid study data. What about ethics in health literacy? From an ethical perspective, communicating using health literacy best practices in the clinical research process is simply the right thing to do. Health literacy is about justice. You can include more eligible individuals if you can communicate in a way that helps them understand the research and supports decision-making. Health literacy is about beneficence. Your communication can be designed to minimize harms caused by not fully understanding the risks and benefits of the research. Health literacy is also about respect. You can support a participant's decision to participate in a study by engaging with them at every stage of the clinical trial lifecycle. Where should you start? Don't worry too much about changing all the documents that already exist. Just start with the next document that's needed for the research and use health literacy principles there. If you don't have a specific document to work on next, you can take some time to reflect. Consider the populations you work with and what you know about them. Are there ways that more health literate research documents and processes could be created for them moving forward? Or you can start by visiting MRCT's website for tools and resources that have been designed especially for clinical research stakeholders like you. Thank you for viewing this presentation on health literacy in clinical research from the Multi-Regional Clinical Trials Center.